Penguin Random House Audio presents Ballplayer by Chipper Jones with Carroll Rogers Walton. Read for you by Mark Deakins, with a prologue and epilogue read by the author.
To the people who make up my team every single day, Larry and Lynn Jones, B.B. Abbott, and the queen of my castle, Taylor Jones.
Forward. The first time I saw Chipper Jones play, he was in high school at the Bowles School in Jacksonville, Florida. As general manager of the Braves, I had gone to watch him with Paul Snyder, our scouting director, leading up to the 1990 draft. I told Paul, "Don't show me which one he is." I wanted to try to pick him out. They were doing exercises with their t-shirts on, not in uniform, and I picked him out immediately. It had to be him. He just stood out. He was 6'4", and you could see right away what an athlete he was. He was a smart kid, too. He had a great family upbringing. He had everything going for him, everything. He's just one of those guys who comes along every once in a while. Jim Beecham, our bench coach for a lot of years, used to call guys like Henry Aaron and Willie Mays and Chipper Jones chosen. He was chosen. He's going to be a first ballot Hall of Famer, one of the greatest switch hitters that ever played the game. Generally, switch hitters don't hit the same on both sides, but Chipper hit 300 both ways. Other managers used to turn Chipper around and make him hit right-handed. He hit more often left-handed because there were more right-handed starters, so they probably did the right thing. But it never bothered me one bit because he could really hit right-handed too. When Chipper was younger, I loved to watch him run the bases. It reminded me a little bit of Mickey Mantle. Jim Hegan, the great catcher for the Cleveland Indians who caught for Bob Feller, Bob Lemon, and Mike Garcia, all those great pitchers, was our bullpen coach with the Yankees when I got called up in 1968. He told me, "You're going to love watching Mickey Mantle run." It was special, even with a bad knee at the end of Mantle's career. Chipper could run too. After his knee injury, Chipper picked his spots, but he could steal a base in a heartbeat. And when he took off, you knew he was going to be safe. Chipper was a tremendous student of the game. He had tunnel vision every night. You'd watch Chipper on the bench and he was zoned in on the game, the pitcher. His wheels were spinning from the first inning to the ninth inning. Nothing ever got away from him, ever. His concentration level was so much higher than most players. The chosen ones, so to speak, could hit at any time, and Chipper was always ready to hit. He could walk up there with tennis shoes on and still hit a home run. The great thing about Chip, he could hit the ball to the opposite field out of the ballpark, both ways. He's a big kid with a fairly long swing, but he could get out in front of the ball with anybody. His ball just kept carrying. You would think there would be a weakness in there. There wasn't. Chipper would get jammed maybe once every 50 games. It was amazing. If they tried to pitch him inside, he killed them. The Mets were one of the teams that did, and he got them good in 1999. You know how great he was? He led the league in hitting at age 36. He was second in the league when he was 35. Leading the league that late in his career is something only the greats do. Stan Musial did it. Ted Williams did it. Chipper was the face of our organization for all those years we were winning division titles, with his ability, his good looks. The name Chipper Jones rings a bell with everybody. We were on TV all across the country with TBS during those days, and I think his name was almost as big in Seattle, Washington, as it was in Atlanta. But Chipper had the personality to go along with the name. He was a superstar player, but he always took the time to sign autographs and take pictures, interact with kids. Chipper Jones was one of the greatest ball players in the league, and we had him. It made my managing job easier. He was a gamer. He had bad knees forever, and he played through everything. And he was as clutch a hitter as they come. Chipper had a ton of great moments in a Braves uniform. His career was something special. I'm glad he decided to share his story, not just with Braves fans, but baseball fans across the country. Bobby Cox, Hall of Fame manager.
Prologue. The last big play. The ball came at me like a freaking bullet, and all I could think was, try not to wear it. The batter, Matt Holliday, hit it just enough to my right, up the line at third base, that I knew I could backhand it. As long as I stayed down and came up, I'd pick it. It was a play I'd made hundreds of times over the course of my 19 seasons in the major leagues. When I was new to third base as a rookie with the Braves, I was scared to death on balls like this. I came off pretty brash and cocky in those days, but most of my confidence came with a bat in my hands. On defense, I had my fears. But at 40, even when the game was starting to speed up on me again, I could make this backhand pick and throw on instinct. I was ready for a ball like this, even in the biggest do-or-die game of my life. If we lost to the Cardinals in a one-game wild-card playoff, my career was over. I'd always prided myself on being pretty good at endings. From the time I was a kid, I'd say to myself, two outs, bottom of the ninth, what are you going to do? I like to think coming through for my team in big situations defined me as a ball player, as much as being a switch hitter, a National League MVP, or an Atlanta Brave for my entire career. Leading up to the night of October 5th, 2012, I'd had 6 months to mentally prepare for what that end might look like, long before Holliday ever picked up a bat and walked to the plate in the fourth inning in front of a packed house at Turner Field. In April of that year, toward the end of spring training, I'd announced I would retire at the end of the season. I got a little misty-eyed telling my teammates, I hope we go out with a bang here in 2012. 7 knee operations had taken their toll, and my body was telling me it was time to hang it up. Percocet and Red Bull were part of my daily routine my last season. Some days I could hardly get out of bed. But by October, I felt like a kid again. I was riding the adrenaline high, and I was determined to make what I still consider the best year of my career last as long as I could. We won 94 games during the regular season, but had finished second to the Washington Nationals in the National League East and settled for the wild card. Bud Selig had added another wild card team from each league to the playoff format in 2012, so instead of playing the Nationals in a best-of-five division series, we had to play St. Louis, a team that finished 6 games behind us in the standings, in the first ever one-game wild card playoff for the right to play the Nationals. It was an instant Game 7. Great for TV ratings, corporate dollars, and Bud Selig. For me, it meant I'd played 2,600 games in my major league career to have it come down to one. And that one game against the Cardinals came down to a ground ball. Up until that point, we'd been in complete control. We were up 2-0, but it felt like 6-0 to me and to the 50,000 Braves fans at Turner Field. The crowd was as electric as any I've ever played in front of in Atlanta. We had 18 outs to go and Chris Medlin, the hottest pitcher in baseball, on the mound. But in the playoffs, a runner at first base constitutes a rally, and that's what Holliday had when he hit the rocket toward me. And I reacted the right way. I mean, I stuck it in the pocket of my glove. I picked it perfectly. But when I grabbed the ball, I had a two-seam grip. I had time to change to a four-seam grip. Carlos Beltran wasn't halfway to second base and make an easy throw. We turn a tailor-made double play and we're all but out of the inning. But instead of taking an extra crow hop and getting a four-seam grip, something in the back of my mind said, throw it anyway. And the ball sailed. For a second, I thought Uggs, our second baseman Dan Ugla, had a chance to catch it. But it hit off his glove. Jason Hayward charged the ball in right field, and Beltran and Holliday were both safe. The Cardinals had runners on first and third with nobody out. And Alan Craig, their cleanup hitter and one of the best hitters in the league that year, was coming up. you could feel the momentum shift. I was standing there at third base thinking, you've got to be kidding me. There's no way that this is how a storybook season ends. The fates had lined up for me in 2012. I mean, baseball had written me a six-month-long Hollywood script. There was a laundry list of cool moments. Not just the tributes and ovations, those go without saying, but things that happened between the lines. A home run, my first game back from knee surgery.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.